In 1942, Basie married a dancer he knew from the vaudeville circuit, Catherine Morgan. The next year, they had a child and would eventually adopt three others. The band continued to evolve, but in spite of personnel changes, the Basie Orchestra that established its reputation at the famous door, with its Kansas City-flavored instrumentals and arrangements by Eddie Durham, Jimmy Mundy, and Buck Clayton, remained essentially the same for more than a decade. This is the band whose outstanding soloists are enshrined as if they were Old Testament apostles spreading the Kansas City gospel, and whose recordings are now regarded as books in the Old Testament of the Basie Bible.
The best-known piece of music representing Kansas City, which is known as Moton Swing. This piece is usually credited to Benny Moton and Buster Moton, but the piece was written by Count Basie and Eddie Durham, who were working for Benny Moton at the time. And Basie was not from Kansas City, neither was Eddie Durham, who was from Texas. Basie was from Red Bank, New Jersey. And he became, however, the outstanding representative of the Kansas City style.
When William Basie was born in 1904, Red Bank was a resort town a few hours from New York by ferry. His father was a caretaker of one of the estates along the river, his mother a laundress.
Well, I had a few piano lessons, but not too many, because I didn't think that I'd want to go that deep into music and all that sort of things. I just wanted to be in show business any kind of way I could be in there. And there used to be a lot up there just from our house down there. And the carnivals and things used to come up there, and there was nothing so wonderful as I thought that sort of show business was alive or happening, and that's where I would like to have been, along with doing something that wasn't no more than feeding the elephants water or whatever that they had to do.
With vague notions about becoming a part of the world of entertainment, he sharpened his skills on the piano and moved to the Harlem of such consummate stride piano masters as James P. Johnson, Lucky Roberts, and Willie the Lion Smith. The young catch-as-catch-can apprentice and journeyman Basie did not attract any special attention and found employment on the vaudeville circuits.
Really, the main guy that really influenced me was Thomas Svetswaller. That was the man that I really did idolize, because Fats taught me how to play what little bit of organ that I do know, and I used to watch him and lay around him long enough to try to style a little piano after him, which was quite difficult.
When we used to jam together, Count was playing twice the piano, three times the piano that he ended up playing, because he took lessons from Fats Waller, and when first running the Count, he could play that. Something else. And Kyle used to be real good at that till he got to where he just changes, got his own style, just like Lester got his own style, you know, where it didn't take but three fingers to do it or something, you know, one chord.
I'd say he was very much underrated. People thought because he played the style, he played the say, oh, Basie ain't doing nothing, you know what I mean? I've heard a lot of people make the statements, but what they never realize that Basie knew what he was doing. And everything was placed just as it should have been placed.
And that style developed and had everybody playing like that. They're still playing like his ending on mostly arrangements of big bands today, you know, how they end with Basie, three notes, bling, 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 bang.
By By the end of the 40s, bookings for big jazz orchestras were scarce. The Basie Orchestra finally broke up in January of 1950, but by the second week of February, Basie was opening at the Brass Rail in Chicago with a six-piece group, which was expanded from time to time to meet specific engagements.
The band sound good, man, it sound good. I had never worked with anybody that with that kind of sound, you know, that kind of discipline. Finally, he had, one night he says, you know, I miss Freddie Green. I got to have Freddie Green on this band. So Freddie Green came, and he joined the group, and it was a different sound altogether. That rhythm was just like a metronome. You know, by him having younger musicians, I guess, they could sound like a big band, even though it was a small group. And Basie would, it seemed like he started playing more piano at that time. I guess maybe it was because it was a small group and they had to do that to help fill up everything. But the band started getting bigger and bigger. Finally, he decided that he just had to have this big band back. He's used to that sound of having a big band. We did a few concerts, and then he decided to break the band up again. It's all over. He kept doing that until he got the people he wanted, you know. It was a little more updated than what it was when they had the other big band, you know. So everything started going from that. And then Joe Williams came in, and he started arranging for him. And all of these things started to melt into a seem like another sound altogether.
They hadn't had a male singer in some time. So I had no, I didn't have any feelings at all about I must step into somebody else's shoes, per se. What I did do, though, was to refuse to do things that he had done. So in joining the Basie Band in 1955, I say, the only thing I had to do was to establish what I wanted to do.
It is 5 o'clock in the morning. There is no one on the street but me. It's 5 o'clock in the morning, and there is no one on the street but me. And I'm evil tired and lonely, 'cause you're not where you ought to be. I'd be so happy, baby, if you were where you ought to be this morning. I'd be so happy, baby, if you were where you ought to be. My whole world is empty, darling, because you're not here with me. Don't think that I don't love you, 'cause I don't write you every day. Don't feel that I don't need you, because I haven't much to say. Here with me, baby. satisfied.
But he said, why don't you come and see what people all over the country think of your work? And I can't give you what you're worth or even what you want right now. But as things get better for me, they'll get better for you. And as fate would have it, I brought Every Day I Have the Blues to the man.
Every day. Every day I have the blues.
Every Day was a hit that brought attention to both Joe Williams and what was dubbed the comeback band by many who doubted anyone could have success with a big orchestra in the 50s. But Basie succeeded, not only in the United States, but beyond, with additions to the repertoire that added up to a sort of new testament.
As far as the comeback band was concerned, as they call it, Neil Hefti was very important. His things were quite popular. They were all recorded, and they're still considered classic albums. But during this time, another genius was, to me, really held things together on a daily basis, was Ernie Wilkins. After that, the two Franks, Frank West and Frank Foster, they were both very important to this era. You know, in fact, Frank Foster, by the time I joined the band in 1962, Frank Foster's work almost dominated the book.
We'd be rehearsing the music. Bass would go in the back of the room and stand up and listen. He just listened. And if it was something he didn't like, he said, now look, the third trumpet, I want you to take that, that section over there that you, the trombone's got, take that whole thing out, leave that open for me. And then when they put it together, they said, okay. He said, now let me sit down and play with you. He sat down and play. He said, now it sounds like bass. This is what I wanted. He know how to get his sound, you know.
Each section knows if it's loose. They feel if it's loose or not, you know. And if there's anything that's happening in there that's pretty strange, they try to tighten it up. You know, you can look. I mean, I know what everybody is thinking, and they know that I know, and I know that they know that I know. But I mean, then the science, and they let them tighten it up because it's always been family. There's no need changing that at all.
He used to pull me off to the side so it wouldn't be no embarrassment. I had played so much bebop until Count Basie said, well, that's all right, say, but don't try to play all you know in one number. And so I say, well, what do you mean, Chief? He said, well, simplicity. Try to make the people understand what you are playing. And said, you can stick around the melody a little bit. The jazz players are not going to hate you for doing that.
From the familiar atmosphere of New York's Birdland, where they were a regular feature, Basie took his comeback band all over the world. They played big tours with other jazz headliners, appeared at jazz festivals that were increasing in size and importance, and regularly backed the most important jazz and pop singers of the day. All of this was continually introducing new audiences to Count Basie.
To me, another one of the most important things that ever happened to the band was that from the time that we worked with Frank Sinatra. Frank Sinatra was at the height of his creativity and his everything, popularity, power, whatever you might want to call it. And he chose Basie to accompany him at this place in Las Vegas, the Sands. Out of this came the classic album, Sinatra, Basie at the Sands. But I might add that the band was very, very good. It was technically, we were clean. I mean, you just sat on the bandstand there and you just, sometimes I couldn't wait to get to work. That's how good I thought we sounded. And so all through these 60s, we kind of lived with that type of thing, and we were on television a lot. We did several successful movies.
There is work to be done, but it's more like a barrel of fun when you sing with the number one band in the land. Let the trumpets blow, come along, let's go. Say, lead on, say, lead on.
In the 1960s, Basie began to be recognized and appreciated as an important American artist. He played presidential balls and command performances for the Queen of England. But Basie didn't forget that jazz was the expression of a dance beat-oriented lifestyle, music for getting with it.
Guys playing, Mr. Basie would have a ball because they'd give him something every night, and they'd give him something, and he'd laugh, and his foot would come off, and he'd throw his head back and laugh because he was pleased that marvelous solo work or something.
In the early 70s, Basie moved his family from New York to the Bahamas, where his wife Catherine hoped he would spend more time. He said it was the first time he felt like he had a home, not just a house. But to Basie, life was being on the road, and he hardly slowed down.
Basie came off after all of those years on the road. He was probably on the road 60 years, and all the situations and all of the adversities and all the successes there, you won't find too many people with too many bad things to say about him. Now, that's some doing.
He was the only band leader that through the years, I would go backstage and say hello to Basie, because I knew he would be the same old Basie that I knew in 1936.
That's right.
He's the only one.
Never changed.
The only one. Let me tell you, and I played with, after I left Michigan, I played with them all, from Duke on down. I'd always go back and see Basie and say hello, and he greeted me wonderfully, just like he did when I first met him.
Basie retired? No. Basie, let me tell you something. It was January 1984, and Basie was quite sick. But somehow or another, you know, he was so famous and he was so determined. He could be backstage and he could just be seemingly terrible, but we would go out into the front and get behind that piano, and somehow or another, he would brace up and, you know, put that smile on everybody, and everybody thought he was okay, but he wasn't okay.
Basie was the greatest band leader
of all time, as I reiterated before.
I second the motion.
Yeah.
I third the motion.
Yeah, what do you say?
There what goes Hayward Henry. Called Basie, worship close. Duke.
Yeah.
And we were together on that, and we were good friends because of that. So yeah. Along with Count Basie, I have to put Duke always.
Well, I have to be with you.
That guy, I think his music is the one thing that will never be forgotten in any kind of way. That's for me to think about because it's I'm a band leader. Mm-hmm. And the only thing way I can do that is for me to stay happy. And for me to stay happy is I see some happy guys around. I mean, I think that can be one of the number one things that can happen in an orchestra. I mean, especially, I mean, like my type, if my band is happy and the guys are happy with each other, I mean, that's it as far as I'm concerned, because then you see that if there's any playing and any sound to be, you're going to get it.
Above all else, Count Basie's work is celebratory and earthy. His hallmark was simplicity, but an elegant simplicity that was the result of refinement and distillation. There is no better example of neatness and precision in the work of any artist in any medium. Nor has any other musician been more completely committed to the proposition of stomping, swinging, jumping, and dragging away the blues. Count Basie died in 1984, but the Count Basie Band is still touring today, and his music remains very much alive. It has earned him a place among the most illustrious of American musicians.
Count Basie's status as a great musician is based not on his extension and elaboration of particulars, as is the case of Duke Ellington and Louis Armstrong. His status is based on his refinement of the particulars that make blues music swing.
I left my baby standing in the back door crying. Yes, I left my baby standing in the back door crying. She said, son, you've got a home as long as I've got mine. When I leave you, baby, count the days I'm gone. When I leave you, baby,
how do you want to be remembered?
Two words. Nice guy.
That was home to me, and I used to tell him all the time, if I'm I'll never be out of a job as long as you have a band, because I'll just get on the bandstand with my horn and start playing, you know? And if you don't pay me, I'll just sleep with you, you know? So we used to have a lot of fun, you know? And that's what Basie was all about.
Baby.